My name is Ajay, and I'll walk you through a very interesting topic today, SASE, ZTNA, and RBI. The idea is to give you more clarity on these upcoming technologies, these new jargons that are floating around. My effort in the next 20 minutes or so would be to give you as much clarity as I can on these technologies. With that, let's get started and let's observe and find out what is what, why, and when of SASE. Of course, let's begin with when. If you go back to 2019, you know, when the word COVID was unheard of, you know, that's the time when Gartner came up with this word SASE. Largely, it was a data center model. You know, this is how most of our customers, most of the networks in the world existed, when there was a central data center, which was very secure, which was fully secured. And there was, of course, VPNs and MPLSs into this network, into this data center to get things done and to consume data and to access applications. And this is when, this is the time in when this model existed. This is the time when Gartner came up with this model called as the SASE model. As you can see, this was in August 2019. And while this white paper spoke about the vision of what SASE is, one of the things that I found very interesting was it helped us pronounce the word SASE. As you can see down there, you know, it was how to pronounce SASE. That was kind of funny. And Neil McDonald, the guy who wrote this, you know, I had an opportunity to meet him and speak to him, and he's a guy with amazing clarity. Hats off to the way they think. So what did Gartner say in 2019 was basically that there will be a convergence of networking and security, and this will converge on the cloud. So basically all the networking and security components will be available on the cloud, which you know, people from various branches, people on the move, people, remote employees, they will all access. And before they access their data, before they access their applications, before they access their content, they will go through this security layer, which will basically protect them. So this was you know, very, very broadly what SASE meant. And little did they know that, you know, this was the perfect solution for today's world. Now cut to 2021. Where you don't ask what is COVID, where everybody is wearing a mask. And as you can see, I'm working from my home. Majority of the population is today working from home, and life has dramatically changed. You know, the SASE has become far more relevant than what it was when it was proposed in 2019. What has essentially happened in 2021 or in 2020 is, you know, some of you might identify this swanky glass buildings. This is a Gurgaon office where most of us worked in offices like this in various parts of the country or world, and now we have all shifted to our bedrooms, right? So what it essentially means is workplace cybersecurity today has become workforce cybersecurity. It is about protecting the user. Doesn't matter whether he is sitting in one of those glass buildings or whether he is sitting in his bedroom or in his house. It doesn't matter where the user is sitting. The user needs to be protected. Precisely, the data needs to be protected. It does not matter where the data is, whether the data is on move, data in rest, data in use, and wherever the user is, doesn't matter. So wherever the user is, wherever the data is, every time the user is consuming that data, that transaction needs to be protected, period. That's the direction in which the cybersecurity is heading today. So if we look at some of the salient features of workplace cybersecurity, is predominantly, obviously, it was all perimeter-based, firewall, infrastructure, complex operations because you had multiple OEMs, multiple integrations, and everything was rules-based. You know, for everything, you would write a rule. It was all IOC-based. IOC stands for indicators of compromise. So basically, you know, when something goes wrong, after that, you would figure, and then there would be tools and solutions which will tell you that this went wrong. So that was the situation in the workplace cybersecurity. Cut to, you know, the workforce cybersecurity, which essentially meant that, you know, it is a distributed zero trust network. It's no longer a perimeter based infrastructure. Like I told you in the previous slide, everything is focused on the user and data. Doesn't matter where the user is, doesn't matter where the data is, whenever the user is consuming the data or whenever the user is touching the data, that transaction, that communication or that transaction needs to be protected. Operations will become very simple because it will be on the cloud. You know, you now need not go and buy servers, buy operating systems, harden your systems, and all those complexities will go away. It will all be checkbox. It will all be on the cloud. It will all make it very, very easy. One significant transition that is happening is from a rules-based model, we will go to a risk-based model. In a risk-based model, it is primarily based on what risk this particular transaction, when a user is touching the data, what kind of risk it has. Based on that risk, there will be a policy that will get activated, or there will be a decision that will be made. So we will look into it a little detail in the next couple of slides. So now we are in a transition phase between the workplace to workforce cybersecurity, and of course we have to deal with both the cloud and on-prem. We have to consolidate, we have to transition. You know, there are regulatory compliances in certain industries. So it is currently in this transition phase that we are currently going. So if we look at it a little more detailed in terms of technologies, right? Of course, firewall is important in the traditional sense. Maybe a UEBA system or an insider threat detection system is important. A DLP, again, an on-prem DLP is important. These are traditional products that people continue to use, people continue to deploy. Then there is where the aspiration is, which is workforce cybersecurity, where what is our aspiration there? Our aspiration is to have a continuous assessment. This is something that the likes of Gartner spoke about, something called as CARTA, which is continuous assessment of risk and threat assessment, which is a continuous assessment at this point in time. Like a typical VPN, it's a layer 3 connection. You give your credentials, the credentials are accepted, you are into the network, and then you can access whatever you can and whatever you will. But in a continuous assessment, that's not how it works. In a continuous assessment, you would access, and every time you're touching or consuming a data, there would be an assessment made as to whether this should be allowed, should not it be allowed. So that is the continuous assessment based on the risk it poses at the time of consumption. So everything is based on risk at that point in time. And this is something that we will talk about in the next couple of slides. And currently, like I told you, we are in transition between the traditional cybersecurity elements to what is called as the workforce cybersecurity, where there is a transformation happening to the newer world. If we go a little more detailed into what exact products, of course, DLP, Insider Threat, AMD, Firewall, SWG, which is a secure web gateway, cross-domain solutions. The transitioning solutions have been Zero Trust Web. You know, this is something that some of our customers have invested in. This is a pure play cloud web security solution, Zero Trust Firewall as a Service, Zero Trust Content, and RBI. RBI is a very interesting solution, right? RBI is remote browser isolation. In a remote browser isolation, what happens is your SWG can tell you whether the website is a clean website or a bad website, or should it be allowed, shouldn't it be allowed. But many a times, SWG would categorize a website as suspicious, but still allow access. In such cases where the content is suspicious, you can always open the web page in a quarantined environment in the cloud. And from there, just render the web page, the HTML web page, by filtering away all other scripts, filtering away all other malware that is running. So RBI is nothing but a quarantined environment in the cloud, and all your web pages, the suspicious web pages, will open in a quarantined cloud environment, and you will only get, maybe for simplicity, let us say, you will only get screenshot of that website. You will not actually get the website. So there is no chance of any script or any malware or any malicious content reaching your end user system. RBI is a phenomenal breakthrough in terms of the way we access and consume internet. DOP is the aspirational workforce cybersecurity product line that we are talking about, which is data user protection, and of course the CSG solution. Both of these we will look into it in a little bit detail in the next couple of slides. So what are we basically talking about is this kind of a framework. This is the Carta framework that Gartner had proposed a few years ago. You can say this is the predecessor of the Zero Trust Network. This transformed or metamorphized into the Zero Trust Network. So what basically happens is, here you see the first picture or the first image is where the user is doing his work, right? So user is doing his work, and whenever he is touching or consuming certain data, a risk is calculated based on what he did, and a score is maintained. So when a user is doing certain risky things, his score can go up, and it can reach a stage where he has done a series of risky things, maybe 3-4 things, one after the other he has done, which are considered risky, which are configured as risky, and then we can automate the firewall to shut him off, or the cloud applications to block him, or we can encrypt his machine, we can block his machine. There are a host of things that we can do, right? If you look at, these are the 9 possibilities that we can do based on the risk parameters. So based on what has been the risk level of that particular transaction. So if I were to take an example, say there are 2 users and both of them are touching exactly the same data, but they can be treated differently because user A might have done a series of things historically in the last couple of days, or last 7-8 days, last 10-15 days, or last 6 months. He could have done something which qualifies him to be a more risky candidate. And then you might want to block him, quarantine him, or you can do allow but throttle kind of configurations, depending on how much risky it is. The same data point somebody else might be touching, he might be doing it, and historically his score might be lower, and then you can probably allow an alert. So based on the historical data of that particular user, what he has done, as far as the risk posture is concerned, we can take a decision to allow an alert, and so on and so forth, till block an alert. So these are the 9 levels that as a policy we can apply on the fly, automatically, based on the risk posture that employee is giving to us. So what essentially happens with this is our users are just not given some black and white rules, but we can now apply risk adaptive policies to them. And moving on in terms of SASE, am I good on time? Looks like. So moving on to the SASE approach. The SASE approach basically consists of an endpoint which is directed to take the traffic to the CSG cloud. CSG stands for Cloud Security Gateway, wherein any internet access that the end user is doing. So here you can see he's working from home, WFH, and through the agent, when he accesses internet, he goes through a web security policy engine. The policy might decide to allow him that web page, not allow him. If it is malicious, we can open it in RBI. Or if he's trying to download something, we can open it in AMD, which is Advanced Malware Detection, which is again a quarantined, a sandboxed environment in which attachments can be taken care of. In many ways, AMD and RBI are very similar. These are sandboxed, quarantined environments. This is for attachments and this is for web pages. RBI is for web pages, AMD is for attachments. And of course, there is a CASB solution for all the cloud applications that the end user might be using from home. So whenever he's accessing a cloud application, he will get directed to the CASB. The CASB will determine, based on the visibility and control, CASB will give controls on what he can do with those applications and what is he allowed to, what is he not allowed to. And if he's trying to download some data, then DLP will kick in to see whether he can do that, cannot do that, who, what, and all those DLP related policies can come in. So all these solutions, all these are the essential features of the CSG solution, which enable a person working from home to very conveniently adopt the SASE model, wherein there is a clean and internet access, clean and safe internet access, and a clean and safe cloud application access without any hardware or deployment on-prem. Everything is on the cloud. Everything can be provisioned and everything can be rolled out very, very easily, because we all know that cloud, rolling out cloud, is far more easier thing than doing on-prem. Same thing, if there are private applications in your data center which are not the SaaS-based cloud applications, and these are private applications running in your data center which you want to allow access, then we can use this particular aspect called as private access, wherein the traffic moves through firewall. Again, the firewall is in the cloud, so it's a next generation firewall as a service. And then this will create a VPN, not in layer 3, but it is a layer 7 VPN, in which you will be able to apply the ZTNA policies as to this particular transaction. The user is trying to access this, say, ERP or CRM or core banking software or anything like that, which is running in the data center. And then we can determine whether it should be allowed, it should not be allowed, can a download be allowed, can an access be allowed. So again, it is at layer 7, so it becomes far more easier than a VPN. Because an alternate to private access or an alternate to ZTNA is a layer 3 VPN, which we all know has severe shortcomings. So this is our SASE approach. This gets bundled along with the DOP product or the Carta model that we spoke about. So wherein there is continuous risk assessment on the cloud. So if I can quickly go back to the slide. So there is continuous risk assessment of what the user is doing, what has he been doing. And we just don't look at historical data of that user. We can also compare him with his peers. Say if there is a guy in finance and there is a guy in sales. So the sales guy is downloading something, the finance guy is downloading something. It could be the same data, but the context can be very, very different. Maybe the sales guy has never downloaded, or nobody in the sales team has ever downloaded this data from the cloud. So if somebody is doing it, it can be seen as a much higher risk. So it's just not historical data of the user. It is what I like to call history and geography of that person. So if the geography doesn't allow, then there is a different treatment. And if the history doesn't allow, then there's a different treatment. So this is a wonderful approach of SASE, which gives you a lot of controls on the way people are consuming internet, the way people are consuming cloud apps, and the way people are consuming data in general, doesn't matter where it resides. So my final slide, what do we do with Forcepoint? You can adopt Forcepoint as a cloud security solution or a hybrid security solution. This is something that is gaining a lot of traction now, because I see a lot of my customers getting back to office. In many of the, I noticed that about 20-30% of the workforce is back in office. So now you need to do both workplace cybersecurity and workforce cybersecurity. So if you have to do both, then hybrid is the way to go. And people who have done investments in cloud-only solutions, today they have no scope, and they are all coming back to the Forcepoint hybrid kind of solutions. Then there is, of course, DLP, which is now available on the cloud and on-prem. Again, both hybrid. You can have hybrid and the on-prem. AMD and RBI, both of which I spoke about. RBI is a phenomenal solution. It kind of gives you phenomenal control over internet, and internet is the biggest source of all hacks, all ransomware. Anything that goes wrong is all starting, and RBI can be integrated with your email server as well. So even in an email, when you get a spam or you get a mail which looks like an original mail, it's not a spam, but it is a spam, then somebody clicks, because you can't train and create awareness to everybody at all points in time. Nobody is going to be vigilant 24/7. People, there will be software moments where people might click on a link which they were not supposed to, and it can compromise the network, compromise the laptop, compromise the user. And that can be prevented by having RBI, both for email, any kind of web traffic, whether it originates from your email or it originates from your browser, doesn't matter. You can have RBI layer in between and get that solid protection. And then, of course, the CASB solution can be that. So this is how most of our customers tend to migrate or tend to adopt if they're taking the standalone approach versus the SASE approach. With that, I think I'm done with my 20 minutes. So thanks a lot. That's my email ID. Feel free to send me your POs on this. Thank you.